Our main speaker today is Pastor Thabiti Anyabwile, a native of Lexington, North Carolina. He's married to his wife, Christy, with whom he has three children, two daughters, Afia and Eden, and one son, Titus. He has served as senior pastor of the First Baptist Church of Grand Cayman, where it is in the low 80s today, I checked, since 2006. He served previously as an elder and assistant pastor at Capitol Hill Baptist Church in Washington, D.C., and as an elder at Church on the Rock in Raleigh, North Carolina. Thabiti holds bachelor's and master's degrees in psychology from North Carolina State University, a former high school basketball coach and bookstore owner. He enjoys preaching, reading, sports, and watching science fiction films. He has authored several books, including The Decline of African American Theology, From Biblical Faith to Cultural Captivity, InterVarsity Press, 2007, The Faithful Preacher, Recovering the Pioneering Vision of Three African American Preachers, Crossway Books, 2007, May We Meet in the Heavenly World, The Piety of Lemuel Haynes, Reformation Heritage Books, 2009, and most recently, Finding Faithful Elders and Deacons, Crossway Books, 2012. Our first respondent to Thabiti is the Reverend Charlie Dates, senior pastor of Progressive Baptist Church in Chicago. Pastor Dates is well known to the Trinity community. While doing his MDiv here at Trinity, Charlie served as a pastoral intern at the New Zion Missionary Baptist Church in Rockford, whose senior pastor is sitting up front today. Then he moved to Salem Baptist Church in Chicago, where he served both as pastor of adult ministries and as a regular preacher as well. Pastor Dates has been at Progressive for almost a year now. He's working on a PhD in historical theology here at Trinity, specializing in African-American Christianity. He's married to Kirsty Dates, another friend of ours here at Trinity, and is now the proud father of a busy baby boy, Charlie Jr. Our second respondent today is the Reverend Lewis Love. Pastor Love is also a regular presence on our campus. He planted the New Life Church of Vernon Hills, Illinois in 1997, a church he serves as senior pastor to this day. He is a contributor to Glory Road, the journeys of 10 African Americans into Reformed theology, edited by Anthony Carter and published by Crossway Books in 2009. He celebrates his 33rd wedding anniversary on February 10th. Congratulations. He has three adult children and seven grandchildren, with one more who is currently on the way. So, as you can see, we've got a great lineup for you today. Would you please join me in welcoming Pastor Anyabwile as he speaks to us on the topic, Jonathan Edwards, Slavery, and the Theology of African Americans. Good evening.
Well, I want to thank Doug Sweeney and the staff at Jonathan Edwards Center and the staff and the leadership at the Carl F. H. A. Henry Center for sponsoring this event and Trinity Evangelical Divinity School for hosting us. It's a privilege to be a part of the lecture series entitled Jonathan Edwards and the Church. And it's a privilege to be with Pastor Love and Pastor Dates thinking about this topic and interacting on this very vital issue. And thank you, the audience, for participating, attending, and engaging with us as well. I've been asked to address the issue of Jonathan Edwards and slavery and theology with sort of a sub-question that goes something like this. Can the theology of a slave owner be trusted, should it be trusted, by the descendants of slaves or anyone else for that matter? That was a less official version of the invitation that Dr. Sweeney sent to me. Putting the question in its most ethnically specific terms, again, should African Americans in particular regard highly and appropriate as their own the theology of one who held slaves? And as you imagine, that question carries the freight of centuries of both Christian moral failure and racial oppression and tension. When we ask, can the theology of a slave owner be trusted? We're not simply proffering opinions about historical curiosities from the safe distance of our own social location. When we ask that question, we're asking a question about ourselves, about the church's understanding of our mission in the world, and about the path to reconciliation. There is a path. Also implicit in the question are certain moral and political assumptions and perspectives, sometimes explicit, sometimes tacit, conservative and progressive points of view. Taboos all around this subject abound. I say all of this just to say thank you, Dr. Sweeney, for inviting me for this very difficult topic. This is how you treat all your visitors to Trinity. But it's an important question, so I want to treat it with as much care and thought as the Lord would give us opportunity today, and leave plenty of room for my co-discussants, Pastors Date and Love, to improve on and correct the thinking that I want to share with you here. In order to treat the question well, it seems to me that we have to make explicit at least some of the implicit issues embodied in the question. To my way of thinking, we might do that really by turning that question like a diamond in the light and seeing five different refractions on the questions. There may be five different things we mean when we ask the question, can we trust the theology of a slave owner? The first variant on that question really is an issue about the slave owner himself. So the first way we might ask that question is as a kind of ad hominem. It's a kind of question about Edwards. It appears to us as a challenge to Edwards' theology, not by questioning the theology, but by questioning the man. Now, we know ad hominems are not a legitimate or strong form of logic and debate, but we don't want to skip this form of the question, because in asking this form of the question, I think we learn something about Edwards and his time, also learn something about ourselves in our time. The second way we can ask this question, it's not just a personal question, but the theological question. So we ask the question, really, what's wrong with Jonathan Edwards' theology proper? Is there a defect in Edwards' understanding of the nature and the work of God in the world? Did Edwards get the Bible's teaching about God right or wrong? The third way we could sort of turn this question of should we trust the theology of a slave owner is to turn it not to the sort of personal aspect or theology proper, but we might turn it to the sort of doctrinal question. And think about Edwards' doctrine of slavery itself. Did Edwards exegete the applicable texts appropriately and then apply them appropriately to the question of the Bible's teaching about slavery specifically? That's the third way we want to think about that. The fourth way we want to think about it is really sort of an ethical question. So we want to question Edwards' ethics. Not question Edwards himself or his theology proper, but when we ask this question, should we trust the theology of a slave owner, it may be that the accent falls on slave owning as an activity. In other words, we're concerned with the social behavior and ethical stance that slave owning implies. We might be concerned, as some claim, that the theological system leads inexorably to ethical blindness, compromise, duplicity, evil. Or we may put it this way. Does Edwards' view of God lead him to live falsely in the world? Well, turn the diamond one more time. Fifth angle, kind of a hermeneutical question. Question about interpretation. A broad topic might be put in terms of biblical and cultural hermeneutics. Is it possible to hold Edwards' theology and at the same time ask questions pertinent to African Americans and their experience? Or does holding Reformed theology, often thought to be, quote, white theology, does that necessarily prevent one from asking, quote, black questions? Can a person be Reformed and simultaneously interested in and caring about the concerns of a particular ethnic peoples? So those are five angles, a personal angle, a theological angle, an ethical angle, a doctrinal angle, and a hermeneutical angle. So let's start with the person. Through his life, Edwards owned a succession of slaves. Now, when you hear slave owner, don't think large plantation. That wasn't Edwards' life. The first slave he bought, Venus, in 1731, it appears he bought really to be as a domestic aid to his wife, Sarah. Edwards, as a man, as a pastor, was largely consumed most of his days in his study, and so the running of the household, which included a farm and some other things, fell to his wife, Sarah. And so it appeared that this first slave that he purchased was purchased as an assistant to his wife. But he grew up in a household where his father, Timothy, also owned a slave, where his uncles owned slaves. And in the sort of first 15 years of his life thereabouts, from 1700 to about 1715, the population of the slave population in Edwards' sort of area in New England grew from about 400 to 4,000. So in one sense, Edwards is growing up with slavery. He's growing up with this system. But after we thought about Edwards, thought about his owning slaves, just even with the bare facts, there's some things we need to say plainly. Edwards was wrong to own slaves. I regard Edwards as having sinned against his fellow man and sinned against God in the owning of slaves. We have to say it's wrong. Something else that we can say pretty quickly, and that is Edwards, like all of our heroes, have clay feet. He has blind spots. This is all of us have blind spots. But even if after we've said those things plainly and quickly, we can't stop there. That's not saying enough, because if we just stop with Edwards is wrong, we're liable to throw the baby out with the bathwater. And if we just stop with Edwards has clay feet, we're liable to give the appearance that we're winking at a serious evil and atrocity. And so we really have to understand Edwards in his time, in his social location, try and think about what might have been Edwards' blind spots so that we might be able to think about our own blind spots and live more faithfully in the world in which we inhabit. And so when we think about Edwards, let's put the question this way, this personal question, this question about Edwards the man. Let's put it this way. Why didn't America's greatest intellectual and theologian, who got so much correct about the nature of God and God's saving purposes in the world, who helped shape Reformed and evangelical Christianity down to this day, who, humanly speaking, was used of God to usher in and oversee a dramatic outpouring of God's Spirit in the revivals, how is it and why is it that such a man failed to take the correct position against arguably the biggest evil in his historical and social era? Well, to put the question another way, if Edwards is all that, how did he miss all this? To answer that question, we really must understand again Edwards in his own social location. George Marsden's biography of Edwards helps us tremendously in this regard. Marsden points out that, quote, the world into which Edwards was born will make a lot more sense if we think of it as British rather than American. Now, it would be nice to just stop and blame the British, wouldn't it? But he goes on to say, Edwards lived in a thoroughly pre-revolutionary British empire. Edwards' world was old world British, more old world British than it was America, as we think of it. Now, this matters immensely when it comes to Edwards' thinking about slavery and the relationship to his theology. Marsden explains it this way. New England, having been shaped by 17th century Puritanism, had its own hierarchism. Edwards was an aristocrat by New England standards. Clergymen in New England wielded more authority and could expect more deference to their opinions than in most other parts of the British world. Further, Edwards belonged to an elite extended family that was part of the ruling class of clergy, magistrates, judges, military leaders, village squires, and merchants. The Starders and Williamses, along with a few other families with whom they intermarried, ruled the Connecticut River Valley or western Massachusetts and parts of Connecticut. They were sometimes referred to as the Connecticut Valley River Gods. We have to think of Jonathan Edwards as a ruling elite, as an aristocrat. He wielded authority and expected deference, and much of his entire family network expected the same. As an elite, then, the concerns of the non-ruling masses, of the oppressed, that ranked a very distant second, if it ranked at all, to the maintenance of authority and station of the elites. Again, Marsden draws out the implications for the question of how Edwards, great intellectual though he was, missed the issue of slavery. This is how Marsden reflects on this. 18th century Britons view their world as monarchical and controlled by hierarchies of relationships. On both these counts, their assumptions were almost opposite of those of most Westerners today, who tend to think of society as in principle egalitarian and in fact controlled by impersonal forces. 18th century British American society depended on patriarchy. One's most significant relationships were likely to be vertical rather than horizontal. Fathers had authority over families and households, the cornerstones of good order. Women, children, hired servants, indentures, and African slaves were all dependent on persons directly above them. Society was conceived of as an extended household. In this arrangement, paternalism was a virtue, not a term of opprobrium. Although British people spoke much of liberty, quote unquote, few had personal freedom in a modern sense. Gentlemen ruled largely through a hierarchical system of patronage extending from the king down. Good order, especially for the lower ranks of society, was enforced by strict surveillance and stern punishments. You see the contrast? Monarchical rather than egalitarian, hierarchical rather than horizontal, paternalistic at the top, dependent at the bottom, patronage rather than liberty, enforced order, no modern sense of freedom. You see, this is not the social milieu that would prompt ruling elites to fight against their own privilege in order to champion the disenfranchised and the marginal. We're not surprised in that most of our theological heroes from this period, without respect to their theology, well, many of them remained silent on slavery or sometimes justified it and even participated in owning slavery. So we would have to condemn them as wrong in doing that. But there's something else that's a blinder beyond just the sort of social milieu of Edwards's day. In addition to his station in life and the old world aristocracy that Marsden paints for us, in addition to that, another set of issues significantly impeded Edwards' apprehension of slavery's issue, in my opinion, evil, in my opinion. To put it in brief terms, Edwards found himself focused on more pressing and visible problems in his day. You might ask now, what could be more pressing than slavery? Probably as you ask that question, we're probably thinking of the plantation South. But again, that's not quite Edwards' context. And for Jonathan Edwards and his family, two things demanded immediate and nearly constant attention: the ongoing skirmishes and wars with the French and their Native American allies, and concern for fostering and continuing the spiritual awakenings and revivals. Historians have well documented the role Edwards played in the awakenings of 1734 and 35, 1740 to 42. Along with George Whitefield, Edwards was perhaps the principal figure in those spiritual revivals. The defense and confirmation of God's work in the revivals fell to Jonathan Edwards as the most astute theological mind and proponent of the revivals. We might liken the criticisms of the revivals on both sides of the Atlantic, we might liken those criticisms really to a referendum on Edwards's entire ministry. Many of us here are gospel ministers, and the thing that we hold dearest is that good news that God has sent Jesus Christ into the world to bear the sins of a sinful humanity. And on the cross, the wrath of God is being poured out upon Christ, and he's satisfying God's wrath to make atonement for us. He's the sin bearer in our place. He's crucified, buried, and resurrected. And in the gospel now, there's this announcement that Christ has not only removed our sin and the guilt of sin, but provided the righteousness that sinners need. Now every man everywhere must repent and believe in Christ. Now we're ministers dedicated to that message. And when men or women come along and say that message isn't true, or say that there is no such thing as men and women being lost in their sin, or that hell does not exist, well, if we're faithful ministers, we gather all the strength we have in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. Well, Edwards in his own time was gathering all the strength that he had in defense and confirmation of the revivals, a work of God as he understood it that was coming under attack both on both sides of the Atlantic. So we can't be surprised in that significant amounts of his energy were invested there. And perhaps that was one of the blind spots for Edwards. We also can't judge Edwards too harshly for his omission when the larger physical threat to New England would have been warfare and negotiation with Native Americans and the French. Now, there had been a slave uprising in New York in 1912, when Edwards was about 9 years old, and a supposed slave revolt in that same city, New York, in 1741. Those conflicts would have been minor and infrequent compared to the almost constant and chronic conflicts and skirmishes with the Native Americans on the borders of the Massachusetts colony and territory. Just listen, for example, to the list of conflicts. This is a partial list of conflicts of during Edwards' life. Queen Anne's War from 1702 to 1713. The Native American sacking of Deerfield, Massachusetts in 1704. The Jacobite Rebellion, 1715 to 16. Father Rale's War, 1724 to 25. King George's War, 1744 to 48. The Stuart invasion of Scotland and England, 1745 to 46. And the French and Indian War, 1755 to 63. At most of Edwards' life, at some point, was involved in or concerned about these skirmishes, these warfare. So to expect Edwards to oppose slavery amidst the conflicts with French and Native Americans would be akin, roughly, to expecting soldiers on the front lines in Iraq or Afghanistan to protest abortion back home in New York. It would be the right thing to do, but it probably wouldn't rank among the most immediate concerns whilst they're in the foxholes. And so I think we picture Edwards in some ways as being in a foxhole, concerned with things, at least in his own mind, that were more immediate, even as we condemn him for missing the obvious fact that slavery was wrong. Again, when we think about Edwards in his own lifetime, it reminds us that he has blinders and we have blinders too. Encourages a certain humility in our own self-reflection. The funny thing about blinders is you don't see what you don't see. And there'll be a generation that looks back on this period, 20 years, 30 years, 100 years, 200 years, and say, how could they have missed that? How could they have been so blind? And so we look to Edwards in part to stimulate our own humility and remind us that if we're going to see things that we won't naturally see, we're going to need inputs from outside of ourselves, from different places, from different times, from different theological positions, from different communities and ethnic backgrounds, that we might have a more well-rounded view of how we're living out the gospel in our own day and time. So that's Edwards in his own situation. Well, that's questioning Edwards. Now, questioning Edwards' theology, and we move through these a bit more quickly. Some contend that the defect leading to Edwards' acceptance of slavery came not from the social mores of the time, but more immediately from Edwards' theology itself. This criticism takes various forms, from generally rejecting Reformed theology to a specific rejection of the doctrine of predestination or election. Now, Edwards was nothing if he was not an ardent defender of the Reformed or Calvinistic orthodoxy that reigned in New England during his lifetime. That orthodoxy maintained that God was sovereign in all things, that God's unfettered control might be as easily seen in the events of history as in the salvation of men. And where the salvation of men was concerned, Edwards promoted and defended what we would term today the doctrines of grace. The Synod of Dort in 1618 and 19 has given us the helpful acrostic TULIP, referring to the total depravity of man. The fact that as sinners, we are corrupted at our root, at the root of our being. There's no part of us that isn't tainted by sin, and sin has left its mark on us in terms of a bent, a hostility toward God. An unconditional election, that God sovereignly chooses for himself a people from every tribe and nation and language to make of them one new man in Christ, and to make of them his new family, his new household. And limited atonement, that the sacrifice of Christ on the cross atones for those who are elect, that it's effective for those who actually trust in Christ. It's sufficient for the world, but it's effective for those who believe. And irresistible grace. God in his sovereign kindness works in such a way by his grace as to bring those he has elected into his saving purposes in Christ, and the perseverance of the saints, and he keeps those that he has saved. He preserves them by his power through faith. In what way could Edwards' theology, at least that soteriology, be thought to lead to his status as slave owner? According to some of his critics, again, it's the doctrine of election or predestination that deserves the blame. They contend that belief in God's predestination, especially in any historical or social sense, tended toward a support of slavery. It tended toward a view of some being superior, chosen by God, and others not. And we can understand why critics would think this, given the kind of manifest destiny-styled abuse that some in misapplying the doctrine have seemed to act upon. But the Bible nowhere teaches that God predestined Africans to slavery. So the suggestion by pro-slavery Calvinists rightly draws our rejection and our ire. But as far as we know, Edwards never argued such a view, never took that position. He cherished the doctrine of election because it undergirded the free grace and love God shows toward undeserving sinners who could never earn his grace, earn his salvation. And already during the New England of Edwards' day, there were defections to Arminian and free will theology. Arminians then, as do many Arminians today, assume or claim that their theological commitments represent a more egalitarian and freedom-loving view. But one simply needs to note the many Arminian theologians and pastors who held slaves to uncover the weakness of that claim. There's no causal relationship or even descriptive correlation, really, between theology, Edwards' theology proper, and the 18th century slaveholding that Edwards engaged in. There's no genetic relationship between the doctrines of grace or a high view of God's sovereignty that leads necessarily to the consequence of holding slaves. Well, the question of Edwards' doctrine of slavery then. The third way we might approach our topic is to sort of ask ourselves the question, should Edwards' doctrine of slavery and slaveholding be accepted by anyone today? This question moves the discussion from theology proper to a question of how Edwards handled the biblical text and applied it to the question of slaveholding. How did Edwards theologize about slavery? What doctrinal position did he take? We have precious little regarding Edwards' formal doctrine of slavery. What we do have comes from one source, a 1741 outline Edwards drafted in defense of a fellow pastor named Benjamin Doolittle. Doolittle's congregation denounced their pastor really for a range of offenses, including slaveholding. The controversy was referred to the Hampshire Association of Pastors for mediation. That pastor's fraternal turned to Jonathan Edwards to write a defense of Doolittle. This case is filled with all kinds of sweet ironies, since the congregants who accused Doolittle were supporters of Edwards' view of the revivals, while Doolittle himself was suspected of being an anti-Calvinist Arminian opposed to Edwards' theology. So the one time Edwards officially addresses slavery, he finds himself defending a slave owner who rejects his theology against a group of parishioners who support his theology. The question is, why would he do that? Now, one writer takes Edwards' defense of Doolittle as evidence of, quote, theological compromise and socially ingrained and acceptable attitudes toward the oppressions of Africans in America. And he continues, the prime motivation behind Edwards' action was the reality that he himself owned slaves. It's not that he felt a great burden against the atrocities of slavery, if indeed he knew them at all, nor that there was great desire to see the institution abolished and men gain the freedom that he and others like him enjoyed as gifts from God. This writer views Edwards as driven, quote, by a dual reality, namely that he owned slaves, and knowing that a threat to the slaveholding of any one minister was a threat to the slaveholding of all ministers, Edwards dismissed theological differences and defended Doolittle to Arminian. Well, that's one view. Perhaps there's another explanation for Edwards' defense of Doolittle. After all, everything else we know of Jonathan Edwards suggests to us a man of scrupulous integrity, theological and otherwise. It seems to me that Edwards' defense of Doolittle had little to do with slavery. In that regard, the writer is probably correct to suspect a kind of socially ingrained attitude toward the institution. Rather, Edwards defended Doolittle because he saw threats to both the New Light revivalist cause and to the clergy-dominated aristocracy that ruled New England. If the parishioners in the congregation could arraign and convict a pastor of whatever theological stripe, well, that signaled a kind of anarchy that Puritan New England and aristocratic elites simply couldn't suffer. I think Edwards is protecting a way of life more than he's protecting slaveholding as such. But should we adopt his views of slavery? Was his handling of the biblical text correct? We might outline Edwards' position by highlighting some things he got wrong and some things he got right from our perspective. A couple things I think he got wrong. First of all, he argued that it was not in itself sinful to use one's neighbor's work without wages. In other words, it was permissible to make one work and not pay them. He was permissible to enslave. Secondly, he defended slavery then as itself, in and of itself, as not wrong. So Edwards doesn't, when he outlines this position to defend Doolittle, he doesn't send an arrow, he doesn't fire a bullet towards slavery as an institution. It leaves it intact. He remains rather agnostic on it, I think, or at least in terms of his writing, supportive in his practice. What did he get correct? A few things. I think he got more correct than he got wrong, even though he's wrong altogether. First, he condemned the transatlantic slave trade, rejecting the idea that other nations had power or right to disenfranchise all the nations of Africa. So he seems to leave domestic slavery intact, but he argues against man-stealing. He argues against the incursions into Africa and the capturing and enslavement of Africans. Well, secondly, he got right. He rejected the idea that Israel's history could serve as precedent and warrant for colonial abuses of Africa. Many of the folks who were arguing, making pro-slavery arguments, were looking back to the Old Testament, looking back to Israel, and saying, see here, there it is in the Bible. It's permissible now. Particularly as they sort of made a link between Israel and the New World and thought of the New World as a city on the hill and a sort of society that would embody the hopes and aspirations of a biblical society. Well, Edwards said, no, that's a sleight of hand. We can't legitimately go back to Israel and find in the Old Testament, in the Old Covenant, any justification for the modern practice of the transatlantic slave trade. A third thing he got right. He held that under the gospel, God would not wink at unjust man-stealing, but called his people to love their neighbors writ large as themselves. He understood that the gospel required love for neighbor and that the man-stealing that led to the transatlantic slave trade, that was contrary, as Paul argues in 1 Timothy 1, contrary to the sound doctrine that conforms to the glorious gospel of the blessed God. The fourth thing he got right, he explicitly denied that idea that Africans and Native Americans were inferior in God's eyes. He did not deny either their full humanity or the need to seek their spiritual good. He regarded them more or less as equal to Christian nations, red white nations, in their rights and their potentials. Another thing he got right, he regarded Africans and Native Americans then as spiritual equals. He was the first pastor in Northampton to baptize and to bring into full communicant membership Africans in a predominantly white church. And finally, in the 1740s, he argued that there could be no advance in gospelizing or evangelism and missions among African peoples until the slave trade was ended. He saw the irreconcilable situation that if Europeans continued in the enslavement of Africans, they would indeed undermine the gospel itself and any effort to reach Africans with the gospel. When you consider that apart from the early Quaker writings, that there was no abolitionist movement to speak of in Edwards' day, it seems that Edwards in some ways was both a man of his time and a man ahead of his time. Still, it won't do for anyone today to take the ambivalent stance that the Northampton pastor took. What Edwards got incorrect jeopardized the lives of millions of African people who lived in the wake of his doctrine of slavery. He attempted, it seemed, to try and thread a needle between ending the transatlantic slave trade on the one hand and supporting the domestic servitude of Africans on the other hand. When he wrote The Congregation in Defense of Doolittle, he chided them for their hypocrisy, for condemning slavery but enjoying the fruits of a slave economy. Perhaps it's fitting to simply state, it takes a hypocrite to know a hypocrite. Or more charitably, Edwards saw the inconsistency of others more clearly than he saw his own in this case. And the only way to resist evil is to be consistently and completely against it. There can be no compromise with evil and injustice. Perhaps Edwards would have developed more completely had he lived longer and reflected more. Again, we only have a fragment of his thoughts on this issue. But given what we have enough to say that exegetically there was more to say than Edwards said. And pastorally, there was more opportunity to say it than Edwards took to say it. At this point, he failed to be prophetic in the best sense of the word, even if his fragmentary thoughts show evidence of his, in some ways, being ahead of his time. Again, our doctrine of slavery is no distant historical and sociological curiosity. Today, slavery ranks behind illegal drugs and arms trafficking as the third largest international crime industry. So modern-day slavery is believed to generate profits of an estimated $32 billion. According to a 2005 report from the International Labor Organization. $15.5 billion is made in industrialized countries. An estimated 14,000 to 18,000 persons are trafficked into the United States each year. Begs the question of us, doesn't it? How alert and active are we even on the issue of slavery? Blind spots. So Edwards' ethics. Some writers of African-American religious history assert that black Christians rejected predestination and election as incompatible with their lived experience in slavery, their hope of freedom in this life, and their view of God as just and benevolent. For example, a great historian, Eugene Genovese, asserts that, quote, predestinarian doctrine did not appear in black religion, and only rarely did Orthodox Calvinism come from the mouths of black preachers, and even in those cases, its uses remain in doubt. Well, that's Genovese's view. But on the other hand, some historians understand Calvinism to have provided, quote, the deepest structuring framework for African Americans during the 1700s. So John Salant writes this. Indeed, Calvinism seems to have corroborated the deepest structure and elements of the experiences of such men and women as they matured from children living in slavery or servitude into adults desiring freedom, literacy, and membership in a fair society. From Calvinism, this generation of black authors drew a vision of God at work providentially in the lives of black people, directing their sufferings, yet promising the faithful among them a restoration to his favor and his presence. Not until around 1815 would African-American authors such as John Gee explicitly declare themselves against Calvinism and for free real religion. See, based on the available evidence, I think Salant presents the more compelling case. But the question we wish to ask is, did the embrace of Calvinism lead African-Americans and others to ethically compromise positions? Is it the case that either Edwards' theology proper or his doctrine of slavery leads inexorably to sub-Christian social ethics? Perhaps the best way to consider that question would be to briefly make mention of the theological heirs, the theological descendants, those Edwardsians that followed in the wake of Edwards. Here I'm thinking of men like Jonathan Edwards Jr., his own son, Samuel Hopkins, two of the perhaps best-known heirs to Edwards' theology, both of whom take up the mantle of slavery's abolition. And the important point is this. The seeds of their anti-slavery were planted deeply in Edwards' own thinking and writing. Edwards' reflection, for example, on benevolence, on true virtue or holy affections, or what he called being in general, left his heirs with a view of godly love that necessitated for them the abolition of slavery. And for that stream of Edwards's followers, slavery ran, quote, contrary to such selflessness and would certainly incur God's wrath. For them, quote, failure to resist the sin of slavery, and it is important that they call it a sin, because before then, men hesitated to call slavery sin. They say here, failure to resist the sin of slavery was as sinful as slaveholding itself. In terms of political ethics, these followers of Edwards, the slaveholder, became what we would call today single-issue voters, saying, as Samuel Hopkins put it, quote, be sure that you never give your suffrage for the election of one to any place of public trust that does enslave his fellow creature. Certain it is that he will enslave an African, would enslave an American if he could. He that will enslave one man would enslave all men if he had power. That's among some of Edwards's immediate descendants, theologically. And African Americans in the abolitionist cause drew heavily on Edwardsian themes in the 1700s and into the early 1800s. Salon identifies three aspects of Edwards's theology that attracted black attention and led to a, quote, a vigorous Calvinist-inspired abolitionism, one in which black people themselves were the authors. And the three aspects of Edwards' theology fueling this protest were benevolence, providence, and the will. And this tradition of black writers took the Calvinism they learned from men like Edwards and improved upon it by working out the implication of Edwards' thought for their social condition. Jupiter Hammond, a contemporary of Edwards, offered an eloquent address to the Negroes of the state of New York. It represented an early eloquent appeal based upon his own Calvinistic orthodoxy for the abolition of slavery. In a generation that followed Edwards, you had men like Lemuel Haynes, a New Light Edwardsian, who in his generation offered what I think was the most trenchant and theologically penetrating critique of slavery and call for abolitionism. And not just a call for abolitionism, but a call for freedom also in the new republic, in the new government that's being formed. So does Reformed theology lead inexorably to complicity and complacency in social concerns? I don't think so. To be sure, the heirs of Jonathan Edwards' theology fell across a range of positions on the slavery question. Those new divinity immediatists, born somewhere between 1725 and 1750, like Hopkins and Edwards Jr., sought the immediate end of slavery. However, those post-Revolutionary War Edwardsians were predominantly pro-slavery conservatives and or gradualists, calling for a gradual, as the word suggests, end of slavery. Then there were the later neo-Edwardsian immediatists born around 1800 who resumed the call, who picked up again the call to an immediate end to slave trafficking and slaveholdering. So there is a kind of diversity of positions on the question of slavery for Jonathan Edwards' theological heirs. That very diversity, I think, suggests to us that one can't draw a dark straight line between Reformed orthodoxy and slavery. Slavery doesn't follow from it logically or necessarily. So Edwards' legacy is mixed, but two things should be deduced from that very mixture. The ethical failures, as I just said, are not owing to either Edwards or Reformed theology. And secondly, the existence of those Calvinists who got it right argues that what matters is following the theological principles to their logical, social, and political end. Reformed theology consistently applies because its biblical truth leads to correct social action. Here's how McKima and Stout conclude their survey. Quote, in Samuel Hopkins and Lemuel Haynes, we have encountered prophetic voices who represent the apotheosis of the Edwardsian tradition. Indeed, on the subject of race and equality, it was Hopkins and Haynes, not Edwards, who were so far ahead of their times that our own is barely catching up. Our final question, a question about hermeneutics. We might put it something like this. Is it possible to hold Edwards' theology and ask questions pertinent to African Americans and their experience? Or does holding a Reformed theological position, often thought to be white theology, necessarily prevent one from raising, quote, black questions. Can a person be reformed and simultaneously interested in cares and the concerns of particular ethnic groups? I won't belabor these questions since their answers should be evident by this point. Not only is it possible to hold Edwards' theology and raise questions pertinent to the African American or any other ethnic group's experience, not only is it possible, we have ample historical evidence of blacks and whites doing just that. Moreover, we cannot limit ourselves to the possibility of raising those contextual questions or approaching the biblical text with a hermeneutical approach that's aware of various social, cultural, and ethnic presuppositions and needs. Not only is that possible, we must, in fact, do it, the contextualizing, and give far more generous attention to the various questions and needs begging investigation from the biblical text. If there's anything that we learn about the interaction of blacks and whites on the question of slavery, is that somehow people are able to occupy different positions socially that in some ways influence the questions they bring to the text. So if Edwards has a blind spot, it might be that he comes to the biblical text on the question of slavery with this aristocratic background too much intact. But as you encounter African Americans with the same theology of Edwards, they come to the text from under the text, from under their social position, from under the pressure of slavery and oppression. And they ask some very interesting and needful questions. And they arrive at some very different social and ethical conclusions. And what that suggests to me is that we need the kind of conversation where people sort of view the scripture from their perch, not above the text, but below the text, yielding authority to the scripture, but wrestling with questions from different vantage points. And that's when our theological discussions will be richest. And that's when we'll be helped with our blind spots. We'll be helped to see things that we wouldn't see ordinarily. And so we have much to learn from each other. And we have much to learn from both whites and African Americans who held Jonathan Edwards' theological position, but also held on to the handle of justice and turned it with all their heart. Thank you for listening.
God can hit a straight lick with a crooked stick. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul, even right now, makes its boast in the Lord, and the humble hear thereof and are glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I was glad when they said unto me, come, let us go to Trinity and respond to Pastor Thabiti. Thank you, Dr. Sweeney, for your generous invitation to participate in today's discussion. I'm not sure what you said to introduce me, but I'm sure whatever it was far too generous. It's an humbling honor to share with such beloved and brilliant people, and I am most grateful for your willingness to address this topic and for all of you being here today to hear what I think is a relevant issue or a discussion on a relevant issue in the academy. I want to thank Pastor Thabiti for, first of all, bringing the Grand Cayman weather to Chicago. God must really favor you to let you do that kind of stuff. And for opening your heart to us all. Yours, of course, is an interesting perspective, and it is helpful to have charitable dialogue surrounding it. Pastor Love, good to meet you, and may God richly bless your ministry. Dr. Sweeney has made it clear that it is my job to respond to Pastor Thabiti's lecture and to build a bridge for discussion regarding its practical importance in the life of the church, not necessarily to answer the question. And as I stand here, I tell you that I am growing in true religion. As James says, that evidence of true religion is that a man is able to bridle his tongue. Five things that I'd like to share with you in our brief time today. First of all, as best I can, although this may infringe upon the rules of the discussion, answer the question right out. Can the theology of slave owners be trusted by descendants of slaves? Unequivocally, absolutely, yes. Of course we can learn from former slave owners. Scripture is replete with failed men who teach us much about God and how to walk with him or not walk with him. Time will not permit us to talk about Noah, who got drunk on the eve of Reconstruction, or Moses the murderer, or David the adulterer, or Paul the persecutor. But like the scriptures, we should deal with the fallenness of great men, even our theological heroes, and not simply get lost in their contributions toward our development. Failure to deal with their fallenness tampers with the glory of God. I'll touch on that in just a moment. Secondly, the historical context of Edwards may be insightful, but it can never be an excuse for his ownership of slaves. Every man is a creature of his historical context, but that should never become the caveat by which we explain or excuse the incongruencies of his theology and his practices. And to that end, thank you again, Pastor Thabiti, for coming forthright out and saying Edwards was wrong. It might have been a minuscule ordeal to Edwards and his family in the 1700s to own a slave or two, but it was a gross violation of scripture and a major deal to the chocolate people of whom he claimed ownership. Be it that he was a part of the elite hierarchical system of his day or not, I certainly don't want that to become code for he could do what he wanted to do and we still would love him outright without critique of his practices. Maybe Newt Gingrich or Richard Nixon or Kobe Bryant would like to be a part of that elite hierarchical system. Third, the ad hominem may be a rule book fallacy, but it is not a biblical policy. I think the scriptures may take issue with the ad hominem fallacy. It is a dangerous dichotomy to separate the man from his theology. After all, if my education here at Ted's is worth anything, it has taught me that I must live what I say I believe. I'm afraid that in far too many dominant, sometimes reformed, not taking a hit at our reformed camp, of which not going to go there. But we cherry pick in choosing to deal with the fallenness of our heroes against others. I cannot tell you how many times I sat in class or talked with peers here at Trinity, and when discussions of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. came up, one of the first things to come out of the mouths of my peers was, you know, he was an adulterer or he plagiarized, as if to scale back on his major contributions to our society. It was almost as though we had to go there first. But it was almost as though we found out on the side that Edwards owned slaves, or that Augustine really hailed from North Africa. These things did not come out forthrightly. And so I say to you today, you might not agree, but our behavior is the evidence of our belief. Jesus says that a tree is known by the fruit it bears. John tells us, how can we say that we love the Lord whom we've never seen? You've never smelled his cologne either. But hate your brother who you see every day. And unless our righteousness exceeds that of the Pharisees, we have no entrance into the kingdom. Fourth, interpreting Edwards in light of his slave ownership keeps evangelicals from hero worship. Oh, some years ago, I was sitting in the class with Dr. Richard Averbeck, and he challenged us to think about why the history writer had inserted the story round about 2 Samuel chapter 11 of David and Bathsheba. It was not, as he said, simply to demonstrate that Uriah was righteous and David was not, but it was also to keep us from worshiping the worship leader rather than being focused on the Lord. Whoever your theological hero may be, he's a crooked stick. Anybody, I suggest, whom God uses is a jerk, at least. And so Scripture keeps us from worshiping our heroes. To that end, finally, I'll say this. My time is up. I'm sure that I gave Dr. Woodbridge some gray hairs. I'm sure that every now and then I annoyed Dr. Sweeney. Mine was the hand that always went up in class when we talked about Edwards to say, hey, yeah, let's not forget this part. As a matter of fact, I remember sharing with Dr. Woodbridge an article, the appendix actually, from the narrative of the life of Frederick Douglass, where he talks about slave-owning Christianity and how he cannot ascribe to that. Very helpful read if you would like to see that. Here is the final thing that I'd like to say. When we teach Edwards, and for those of you who re-preach his sermons annually, we must tell the class or the church up front about his shortcomings. This is to the point that I mentioned originally, and that is, in the sovereignty of God, he does hit straight licks with crooked sticks. And if you do not share with the class or the congregation that Edwards was a failed man up front, you run the risk of leading your class or your congregation into believing something about a man that could be beyond the glory of God. It is that God chooses to use fallen men, even Edwards. I wish that I could go back and talk to Edwards. It might not do much good. I wish that I could slip him a text message or tweet him. His sociocultural construct and his theology might not push him to worship with me, but it ought to keep him from owning me.
Take issue with the jerk thing. Dr. Sweeney, I thank you, and the Jonathan Edwards Center for maintaining and in some ways stimulating interest in Jonathan Edwards. And that makes this subject that we've been talking about very practical, necessary. In 2004, I had the privilege of training a young man for ministry. He was a student at Moody. He was beginning to embrace Reformed theology. He had heard me speak often of Edwards. I noticed that he was quoting him as well. I knew he would sooner or later fly into some turbulence with his newly found Reformed leanings, so I thought I would pull him aside and give him a heads up on Edwards and slavery before one of his Arminian well-meaning brothers had laid it on him at Moody. So I did. And for 8 years, I never heard him even mention Edwards' name until 2 weeks ago in a sermon. My 8-year-old grandson looked over my shoulder and saw the theme of today's gathering. And with as much alarm as he could muster, he said, "Papa, Jonathan Edwards owned slaves?" And I said, "Yes, he did." He then said in a disgusting tone, "None of my books on Jonathan Edwards ever said that." The next question he posed to me was more penetrating than the first. He said, "Papa, did he whoop them?" My grandson knows my father. who would be his great-grandfather. He comes to town from time to time. He'll be 80 years old into this month, Lord willing. And he drives up, and he gets to town, and he wrestles, and he plays with him, and he talks with him. And I thought about this other day. If I could wrestle and play and talk with my great-grandfather, I would probably ask him a question similar to what my grandson asked me. I would say, "Grandpa, did they whoop you?" And my great-grandfather was a slave. So again, Dr. Sweeney, I thank you for hosting this most difficult but necessary conversation. And I'm grateful to be a part of it. I thank you also, my brothers in the gospel. Church I grew up, we call you fellow yokemen of the gospel. Pastors Anyabwile and Dates, I've learned much from both of you. It's also good to see many of you here today as well. Your attendance speaks volumes as to the importance of this topic. I've been charged, like Pastor Dates, with a pastoral response, which seeks to apply the theme of Pastor Thabiti's talk to the church and provide a bridge for our panel discussion. By the way, being the last speaker today, I don't know how I got that assignment, but being the very last one, you cannot ask me any questions at the panel discussion. Your talk was very helpful, Pastor Thabiti. I found especially useful the method you used in breaking the initial question down into smaller, manageable questions. In your smaller questions, you maintained the great contribution that was and is to the church without minimizing the evil of its practice of holding slaves. As a matter of fact, you called Edwards' holding of slaves ethical blindness, compromise, duplicity, and living falsely. Furthermore, you referred to slavery as a wide-scale and diabolical social problem. So to point out the heinousness of slavery and all its components is not only helpful but necessary in order to get a hearing of Edwards by many of the descendants of slaves, Pastor Dates. Ian Murray, in his book titled Jonathan Edwards, A New Biography, makes a critical error of attempting to play down the heinousness of Edwards' slaveholding. He writes, "Black household servants bought as slaves or belonging to households from birth were comparatively common in New England, and there were several connected with Edwards' home at various times. Mercy," was her name, "appears to have been one of the favorites among the children. The life of these blacks who took their place at family worship and in the meeting house every Sunday had little in common with slaves depicted by a later New Englander, Harriet Beecher Stowe, in her Uncle Tom's Cabin." Regardless of Murray's eyewitness account of the treatment of Edward's slaves, the institution itself, as you said, was evil. This is very important for getting the conversation started because it begins with honesty. If we're going to hold to the truth of what Edwards taught, we must be willing to hold to the truth of what Edwards did. How then did he do it? How can a man of such theological acumen live in the sin of slaveholding? One of the facts you proposed was that we must come to terms with Edwards as a man of his time. And I really appreciate it, Pastor Anyabwile, that the historical context, my brother, is always so thorough. This information is vital for our understanding of this great theologian. However, what is most troubling about the context in which Edwards lived was, well, his known position in that context. He had a privileged lifestyle, but more importantly, he was a clergyman. You quoted Marsden, and clergymen in New England wielded more authority and could expect more deference to their opinions than in most other parts of the British world. This is the real problem, is it not? Regardless of all others in the privileged ruling class of New England, her ministers must be different. Therefore, as we further this conversation about the benefit of Edwards, I'm not so sure that the Edwards in his own time and social location argument would be persuasive to most descendants of slaves. The cry among the descendants of slaves is for the ministers to be more prophetic. They must speak to the culture. They must, or they would say, "Yeah, that's true, but Edwards, after all, was a preacher." Therefore, I sense that the cultural argument would be somewhat counterproductive. If there is evil in the culture, her ministers must be the ones who detect it first and sound the cry against it. like what we know of Samuel Hopkins and Lemuel Haynes, whom you quoted, were so far ahead of their times that their own is barely catching up, that our own is barely catching up. Thus, we should be and will remain surprised, indeed, that most of our theological heroes from this period, without respect to their theology, remain silent on, justified, and even participate in African slavery. The culture's men who are handling the scripture must be men of Issachar, having an understanding of the times and knowing what Israel ought to do. Edwards failed, and being prophetic in his time, he failed to bring the full load of scripture down upon his practice of slaveholding. These two issues stand out for me, the heinousness of his slaveholding and the failure to see it as a minister. What then must we do with the theology of one who failed so miserably in such a far-reaching way? Pastor Anyabwile also said that 2.5 centuries later, we find Edwards' doctrine of God's sovereignty and action in history and man's opportunity to delight himself in the glory of God, inspires, it guides, and satisfies countless worshipers. I said to myself when I read that, now, ain't that the truth? I recalled when I was first introduced to Edwards via John Piper's God's Passion for His Glory. The second half of the book is the text of Edwards, the end for which God created the world. This is the first thing that I read directly from Edwards. No motion of God's last end in creation of the world is agreeable to reason, which would truly imply any indigence, insufficiency, mutability in God, or any dependence of the Creator on the creature for any part of his perfection or happiness. God is perfectly satisfied in himself. Edwards goes on and says, though it be true that God's glory and happiness are infinite and cannot be added to and are perfectly independent of the creature, yet it does not hence follow, nor is it true, that God has no real and proper delight, pleasure, or happiness in any of his acts or communications relative to the creature. He delights in us. God had respect to himself as his last and highest end and in his work because he is worthy in himself to be so, being infinitely the greatest and best of beings. All things else with regard to worthiness, importance, and excellence are perfectly as nothing in comparison to him. All that is ever spoken of in scripture as an ultimate end of God's works is included in that one phrase, the glory of God. It's like it was yesterday when I underlined that entire section in the book. What I read about Edwards that day wasn't about Edwards. It was about God. He wrote amazing things about God that I never thought of in any way like that before. My gaze wasn't set upon Edwards. It was set upon God. Now, let me end with something a good friend told me when I queried him about this topic. He says, our responsibility as Christians is not to make much of the theologian, but of Christ. The theologian is only useful insofar as he points us to Christ. Ultimately, my allegiance is to Jesus. I use Edwards, Calvin, Luther, Abraco, Owen, etc. Where he is useful and where he is not useful, I put him down. I won't hesitate to state my reasons for doing so. I imagine that's why the young preacher who I mentioned earlier, after 8 years, picked Edwards up again. That's why my grandson will get a couple more volumes on Edwards from me. Hopefully, they'll be a tad bit more accurate. Thank you.
Well, many thanks to Pastor Anyabwile, to Pastor Dates, and to Pastor Love for exceptionally helpful presentations. We do have about 20 minutes for discussion. We're looking forward to discussion with all of you. Those of you who came in a little bit late, let me just bring you up to speed. We're recording today's session, so what we'd like to ask you to do is line up behind the microphones in the aisles so that we can record both your questions and responses from today's speakers. Maybe, Thabiti, the first thing we ought to do is ask if you want to take a minute and say anything in response to your respondents. If you don't have anything that you want to say, that's fine, too. We can jump straight to questions. But if you want to say anything about what Pastors Love and Dates have said, that'd be great.
Thank you.
We could probably move the questions. I think I agree with everything they said. And you know, it's probably not politic for the guest who's invited and honored to protest. But I want to be the respondent next time, man. I got to speak with a little bit more swagger, you know. That was all right. So, they did a wonderful job. I'm thankful. I'm humbled to be sharing with them. So why don't we go to questions?
We knew you could handle the hard jobs. Well, that's why we asked you. Any questions from the audience? And maybe Charlie and Lewis, if you don't mind, come on up, and just in case the questions are directed to you as well.
Can I hide behind them?
This way. Well, while audience members are formulating questions, maybe I'll get the ball rolling. And I'm not sure this is going to be a central question for everybody, but I'm a church history teacher, and I'm very interested in the ways in which pastors decide to use figures from history, whether it's biblical history or post-canonical church history, in their ministries. I've thought a fair amount about better and worse ways to hold the saints up, you know, from church history, either for emulation or for criticism or for both. Any wisdom, pastoral wisdom, from your experience in the pulpit and in teaching ministry in the church about better and worse ways to hold up examples of godly living for people to follow.
That's a fabulous question, so we're just not standing up here with the white space. I think Lou was doing an excellent job of it just now. One of the things is those folks who've gone before us, we read them hoping that they have read their Bibles well, and hoping that the product they're reading their Bibles well help us to see God. I think the best use of the historical illustrations are often using them as illustrations for pointing people to aspects of the character and the glory of God that we might not see otherwise, or they're helpful for highlighting. I thought Charlie made some excellent points about not valorizing our heroes in such a way that it eclipses the glory of God. So I think implicit in what he was saying there is that principle of using them in a way that points to God and not to the theologian. I think you want to hold up people that are going to edify and not be stumbling blocks. It was in a different panel, and a young woman stood up and said, you know, she goes to an ethnically diverse congregation in Southern Virginia, and last week the pastor, used in his illustration a couple good old boys, a couple, you know, Confederates who they were celebrating and so on and so forth, and she was pointing out basically the pain and the stumbling block that was. I thought it was pastorally irresponsible. So there may very well be things I would read in my own study in history and so on that I would never bring to the pulpit for fear of the negative effect it would have on parts of the congregation or the congregation as a whole. So it needs to edify. So off the top of my head, those would be two principles.
I wonder too, Charlie, would you say that the ways in which we do this for our people might well depend on the context and on the people? What I have in mind is some folks need to know Jonathan Edwards owned slaves. Some folks need to know Martin Luther said terrible things about Jews, you know, that kind of thing. Other people are in situations, it seems to me, where if we're as critical as we academic types are trained to be critical of other saints, we can kind of weaken their faith. We're pulling their role models away from them. And I'm not suggesting that we take this principle and whitewash Jonathan Edwards. But I wonder sometimes if pastorally you struggle with when to focus on criticism, when to focus on the really fine parts of somebody's godly example that really ought to be emulated, and how you find the right balance.
Dr. Sweeney, you might be disappointed in that I rarely, if ever, talk about Jonathan Edwards at our church.
I am shocked.
I don't even think they know who he is. I think that it is the pastor's job to know his congregation and to know his people. And to that end, where you can find illustrations that are helpful, and you handle them responsibly, then it's perfectly fine. I wish that there was perfect. I wish that there were more discussions from the pulpit where some of our great theological heroes are brought up. I wish that there were more discussion about who they were as people and not simply by the content of their presentation. So that would be helpful, but that's my take on it.
I think, Dr. Sweeney, I think also it comes to introducing the people to theologians of the past. Yeah. So they won't be shocked when you get the whole gamut of theologians. You talk about Edwards, Luther, Abraco, the Dutch people, you know, what that whole issue that some of them were involved in. It helps the people to know that all of these people are not saints without flaws. So then when you introduce them to some of their flaws, it's easier for them to take it because they see the full gamut of theologians. But if you mention a guy every now and then, you might run into problems.
Yeah. Hands.
Yeah, I got a question for perhaps Thabiti or even the whole panel. But I've been in conversations with friends, and Jonathan Edwards and others like that have come up. And I'm just wondering what your reaction is with this to this perspective, which is that when they have found out that Edwards owned slaves, and as all of you have mentioned, just the deep problem the deep sin that represents, the reaction is just to not have anything to do with Edwards at all. And you know, there are ministers who are caught doing heinous things, and I think there's a general kind of reaction that, you know, that pretty much, as Charlie was saying, that pretty much reflects, they're damaged goods now, and I'm not going to go there for wisdom any longer. So I'm thinking about this reaction. What would you say to someone? I don't feel I need Edwards. If he owned slaves, that was such a terrible thing. That sin was so bad that there's just no way to redeem that. And it's akin to any other kind of heinous sin that a minister might be involved in. What would you say to that perspective?
I think there is a kind of theological, sociological response. That's part of the first part of your question. Why do, if I could paraphrase, why do African Americans or some of your friends respond so negatively and absolutely to Edwards and appropriation of Edwards? But then I think secondarily there's a kind of pastoral response I would want to make. On a social level or a theological level, you know, I think part of, look, African Americans are people with no return address. Folks stolen, transported, planted, abused, disabused of ethnic, social, religious, cultural connection to a particular people on the continent. What that has meant is that socially we've had to forge an identity. And we've had to forge that identity in part in response to people trying to define us. So what it means to be black is in one part what you positively construct out of the mess of slavery. But it also means what it means to be black is in part a construct, a defense against what people say about you because you're black. Now what that creates is two things, I think. It creates a natural affinity for the group, because now we've got this shared experience, call it black, right? And a shared identification with that history. Even if the history is 300 years old, it's still sort of ours. It's part of how we define ourselves. And reflexively, it creates that instinct to respond to the threats against that identity, against the community. Sometimes swift and categorically. So you mentioned Edwards as a slave owner. Boom, the wall drops. A lot of African Americans. I don't need to talk any more about that, you know, because I know where that goes. I know what that did. I still, in some way, suffer from that, you know. So I think that's part of why you get that response from some people, at least. The other thing, though, I want to say just pastorally is, while I understand that response in time, I don't want to leave people responding that way, because I do think we want a certain kind of humility, even in the face of clear and egregious evil. So, let me tell you what I mean pastorally. I more often have people in my study who say, my spouse cheated and I'm done. And they're responding to the sin of another in a categorical absolute, I'm done with that. And pastorally, part of my job is to help them now apply the gospel in the midst of that hurt. So that they have the victory and the freedom that Christ has purchased for us in the gospel, and so that can be applied in such a way that they reconcile now with the spouse that's betrayed them. It's the same kind of reaction on a different scale. And pastorally, what I want to do is just be kneading the gospel into the hearts of my people in such a way that not only are they in this interpersonal thing able to get over hurts and abuses, but even in time as they grow and mature and reflect differently, like the young man 8 years ago who cut off Edwards but now is quoting Edwards, they have freedom to appropriate and freedom to nuance and freedom to sort of take and reject, not just categorically, but, you know, systematically as it serves their souls. Is that helpful?
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. Good afternoon. Great job. Dr. Thabiti, I think you alluded to a biblical or theological definition of slavery. If you can elaborate on that somewhat. And the second question is, or maybe it's perhaps a summation, Jonathan Edwards being as aristocratic as you've indicated in his time, would that be any different than later years, later slave owners? The common thread, I believe, in slave ownership was the dehumanization of a people, of a person, to the point that they were not people. That we were property, that we were something less than human, perhaps, which justified this institution called slavery?
Great question. See if I try to remember both parts there. One question was about sort of a biblical doctrine or a theological doctrine of slavery. All I was simply trying to say there is, as we look at how Edwards wrestled with slavery, it seems to me he took a position that was inconsistent. So on the one hand, he rejected the transatlantic slave trade, the kidnapping and the transporting of slaves across the Atlantic into the Caribbean and into the New World. He rejected that as man-stealing, probably thinking of 1 Timothy chapter 1, around verse 10 or so. But what I think he failed at is sort of the second part of your comment, which is to sort of reject the institution itself. So he seemed comfortable with domestic slavery, and the perpetuation of domestic slavery, even while he was uncomfortable with the transatlantic slave trade that created domestic slavery, right? Big inconsistency, I think doctrinally unfaithful to the biblical witness. Do I think he, I'll stop there. The other thing I think I want to say about Edwards in his time, though, is now Edwards is writing, again, he's dealing with this at a time where there is no abolitionist movement. And you also don't quite have yet, at least, as strong and as popular as it would be in a couple generations following Edwards, quite the same amount of artillery arguing for the subhuman nature of African peoples. It's clear in his own writings, though, Edwards never took that view. And so the sort of our modern notions of race, which were sort of growing up about that time, really, 1750s, 1800s, really taking hold about that time. Edwards seemed not to be so infected with that notion as we are, and the particular part of history that you're talking about in that way. Is that helpful? Yeah.
It's the mindset that was created.
That's right.
Yes.
I can't pronounce your name.
It's all right. They call me Pastor T, man.
Okay. You mentioned some other things that could be happening in a modern culture that we could be blinded to. You mentioned the underground weapons trade, and you mentioned human trafficking. But my question is like twofold. Do you think that's really as the forefront and prevalent and in the conscious of Americans and other people across the world as slavery was? And if it is, how can we combat that when it appears that we live in a time where there's one people that side with the gospel, where they're salvationists or soterians, where, you know, all my job is to do is save you and get you to heaven, where there's an oppressed group that speaks more prophetically and say, you know, my job is not only to save you, but prophetically rid the things that may oppress you. So how, when we have divided congregations and is looming social ills, how can we even get people to be on the same page of combating the two or three or whoever exists?
Let me try a couple quick responses. I'm not sure I'll get all your questions. If I miss your question, let me know, okay?
Okay.
Again, one thing about blind spots is they're blind spots. So you don't see what you don't see. And this is why it's critical that we be in social, theological, political conversations with people sort of not like us, because they see differently from us. And if we listen and are humble enough to learn, that helps us with some of our blind spots. So part one of my answer is, because they're blind spots, I'm not sure I can put my hands on what they are. Part two, in terms of how do we work prophetically, you know, and take a stance against some of those things, assuming those kinds of relationships where we see and hear from one another, and assuming the guidance and the authority of the biblical text, I think we preach and apply the text, both from the pulpit and in conversations with the pew, in ways that are appropriate. And I think we have to leave room for the flowering of many causes, right? So Church A doesn't have to be involved in sex trafficking, ending sex trafficking, in the same way that Church C does. But I want to presume and hope that Church C and Church B are perhaps more active on some other fronts and some other issues that Church A isn't. So I think we have to have a big notion of the church. I think we have to have a big notion of coalescing together. And allow room for a kind of, in the best sense of the word, charismatic use of gifts and energies to address sort of multiple problems that the scripture warrants we address.
Okay.
That's cool.
To that as well, concerning blind spots, and I think, Pastor Thabiti, you were alluding to it, and that is this. You know, the body of Christ is made up of many members. That's actually one body. What's blind to you may not be blind to me. And if you actually talk to me, then I can tell you what's in your blind spot. And if I talk to you, then you can inform me of the same. I think what happens is we form our separate enclaves. The churches in the northern suburbs don't kick it with the churches just south of the White Sox Park where we are. And so they aren't even aware of some of the issues that are going on where we are, vice versa. We could perhaps turn the tide with history by saying, yes, the church did respond to something that was a blind spot for certain groups because they talked with one another. So I came to this divinity school, not predominantly African-American, had some other options there to attend. But what this has done for me now in pastoral ministry, it has opened up my mind and my heart to issues that I would not have gotten somewhere else. But then I don't close off the people who've gone to the other schools who might not share the theological convictions that I have to the T. I embrace them, actually, and at some point hopefully learned how to separate the wheat from the chaff. But those discussions are incredibly important to preventing further blind spots.
Why don't we go to my right first, and then we'll go this way.
My name is Jim Schranz, and I am a non-academician at all. I'm just a friend of Doug and Hans here, but I do have a question, and it kind of came to my mind as the three of you were talking that Jonathan Edwards has great theology, and I would never deny that after reading several of his works, but the issue that he doesn't touch on and leaves unresolved causes great pain, great death, and great loss for another 200 years. And as one of those, what we'd call now the 1% of his time, he had the ability, and I would say the obligation, to address the issue of slavery and guide people away from it. And by not doing that, we go all the way through the 1940s and even into the 60s, and things are terrible for a lot of people. And by not addressing it, I look at that as a terrible thing, to not address that at all and to leave it lie, because it causes a lot of death over the years.
Amen. Yes.
As an African American listening to a conversation like this, and I can't help but noticing that the very reason that something like this is relevant is, and the very reason that something like this can even be listened to is because there is a, as another speaker said before me, huge amount of pain that just looms tacitly under issues like this. And that's the whole reason that this whole conversation makes sense. So I addressed a question to all three speakers. A professor said to me yesterday that the issue of racial reconciliation, this pain, this strife, this obvious need for us to, as Americans, white, black, multiracial, reconcile, is not a social issue, but a theological issue. Racial reconciliation, this professor said to me, is a theological issue, not a social one. And the whole sweep of the biblical narrative that culminates in Revelation 7, where we see all tribes, tongues, nations worshiping the Lamb together. And the professor said that the core of the Bible's message even is reconciliation. Echoing the speaker before me, two speakers before me, yes, how do we do it today? How do we reconcile today? But also, how does suppressing Edwards or not reading Edwards contribute to that kind of reconciliation, contribute to Christ's personal project of reconciling us to one another? How does suppressing Edwards contribute to that? Or how does other similar, you know, moves contribute to that? And how can we, number two, how can we move forward with real reconciliation, not just talking about topics with issues that promulgate those topics left just painfully unresolved, even after the conversation?
John, you want to go first?
Oh, really?
Yes.
No, Ian, I don't think that suppressing Edwards helps with reconciliation. I think that when you come to reasons why people do suppress Edwards, I think it points reconciliation in the other direction, and it keeps these warring parties at bay. One of the things that I think that Edwards brings to us today in this whole topic of reconciliation is it makes us deal with this issue that is hurtful, that is painful. And I was having this conversation in the barbershop just today, telling them what I was going to be talking about, right, just to get their feel for it. And two African-American brothers, as a matter of fact, one mid-30s, other one around my age, a very young man in his 50s. And so when I asked the question to them, both of them said this remarkable thing. They said, well, we have to forgive him, don't we? And the answer is yes. We have to forgive him. You know, and that's what brings reconciliation. When you, as Pastor T was saying, you have those two people in the office or that person in the office, I'm done with this. You know, I've been offended. You know, and I've been wrong. You know, and you have biblical grounds for it. But the higher call, the higher ground is reconciliation. Because that's what the Bible does teach. That's what Jesus shows us. That's what we have. And we can't, I don't think we can consistently claim reconciliation while denying it. If that answers your question.
Sure.
I'm not sure that I have an answer. Actually, I got stuck on if it's a theological issue or a social issue. And I would argue that it's both. Dr. King said, you know, the law can't make a man love me, but it can keep him from killing me. That kind of thing. At some point, you've got to move from what is theologically correct, which the world, as we know, will not embrace, and involve the powers that be in society to make things different. So I never move past that part of your question. I'm sorry. That's why I was caught off guard. I think it's both, and I think evangelicals, let me make my shameless push for this. evangelicals need to be involved in the political process, not simply on a national level, but also in their local communities. And that, of course, beyond the blind side of the Republican Party, but in all aspects of what's going on there, because if we do not bring theological truth to social consciousness, then we may never impact real change.
Just real quickly, I agree with Charlie. I do think it's race, and therefore racial reconciliation is certainly a social construct. So it's a social problem and it's a theological problem. I want to suggest there's an ordering, though, to those two things, that first we have to bring to bear all the theological resources of the scripture and of the gospel, as Lou was saying. You cannot separate the issue of race, the categories of race, from the power dynamics that are vested in them. So part of why I would argue we need a more radical project on this issue than racial reconciliation is because the construct itself has just freighted with it, inherent in it, all the things that make us have to be reconciled. Prejudice, bigotry, power, disenfranchisement, privilege, so on. The categories were made to serve those agendas. The categories won't get us out of that quagmire. The more radical project, it seems to me, is to begin to conceptualize self and identity in more radically biblical terms. Acts 17:26, he has made from one man all the nations of the world. The table of nations in Genesis chapter 10. We read it like a story of discontinuity, but it is an illustration of how Genesis 3 tells us that Eve became the mother of all living. There's a close cousinage that's true of us. We're ethnic groups, but we're not distinct biological racial categories. And that old language of race and that old construct of race, in part, is the real enemy. Now, when I say that, I don't in any way mean to be dismissing the kinds of experiences we all have had that we interpret through the lens of race. But that interpretation and that lens is killing us. And it seems to me that the next great move in terms of progress on this front is bringing to bear the theological resources first, the biblical resources first, for redefining ourselves, putting ourselves, as it were, under a different power, namely Christ, and then working out the social issues from that vantage point. So,
may I add on to the suppression of Edwards question, just as a church history teacher? Obviously, I don't think it's a good idea to suppress Jonathan Edwards. I teach a class about him here, and I direct one of the Global Edwards Centers. I do think, though, it is a problem when people teach classes on American Christianity at seminaries and spend more time teaching the students about Jonathan Edwards than they do teaching the students about all of African-American Christianity put together.
Amen.
So for me, it's not so much a question of putting somebody down, but raising other folks up and developing presentations of our history and our identity as Christians in this country and around the world that are more balanced.
Amen.
I think these two questions will have to be the last. Why don't we go this way first, and then we can end with Gavin.
This is for the entire panel. We often draw the distinction between committing an act of sin and perpetually living in sin. So that, you know, if you get counseled by a pastor and somebody comes to you and say, well, you committed one act of sin, but you've been doing it for 10 years, you know, is that conversation helpful when looking back at Jonathan Edwards, at a man who didn't own a slave for a day or 2 days, but years? How does that help us in looking back at him, this perpetual nature of living in sin? Or is that conversation even helpful at all in looking at Jonathan Edwards?
Charlie, what's that?
Oh, well, looking at you.
Right, can we buy you some time? I'm not sure how helpful the category distinction is. If he had owned a slave for 5 days or 5 minutes or for 50 years, it's wrong. I mean, I know why it makes a difference in terms of how we sort of think about his life, or if it's brought it present day, how we might counsel differently and so on. But in some absolute sense, I want to say it doesn't make a difference at all to me, sort of categorically. But the other thing I want to say is I think we really must lay hold to this. It ought to be the case that the preacher's life, as my brother said in their responses, conform to their beliefs. But we really do need to say we preach a better gospel than we live, all of us. And we just need to be humble before that fact. So that I'm quite aware that if I'm going to be faithful to the biblical text on a Sunday morning, there are some things I'm going to say and call the people and myself to that I'm not yet doing. Right? And I think as folks who care about theology, we see a connection between our theological belief and our action. And I just want to encourage us at some places to recognize that that's a dotted line, not a bold line. That our theological positions don't always lead ipso facto to the right behaviors that we want. It's just part of our fallenness. That's not to excuse it. This is why I start with, I'm not sure it matters if he held a slave for 5 minutes or for 50 years. It's wrong. And I don't want to excuse it. But I also want to say, we all preach a better gospel than we live if we preach the gospel in its full.
All right. All sin is punishable by death. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Edwards, of course, needed that same grace that we do, whether he did it one day or not. As a matter of fact, one day of sin, or as Pastor Copeland would say, at New Zion, it doesn't matter if you've told a lie or if you smoke cocaine. Either way, we're all in the same category, and that is hopeless. It does, however, shade my perspective, I'll say, and perhaps this is part of my fallenness, that Edwards, until the end of his life when he lived on the reservation, so to speak, I think even at that point, mm-hmm. he had some major repentance going on in his life. It does bother me that he held them for so long, but like Ray Charles, man, he got clean at some point. In a major way. And that's what helps me to celebrate Jonathan Edwards for real. And therein lies the hope for those of us who tend to preach one better than we live one. At the end of the day, too, though, Paul says, know no man after the flesh. He says, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. The measure stick for Edwards is Christ, not us. Mm-hmm. The same for us. Mm-hmm. However, with that being said, he's a mere man, and we're all measured in some sense by something larger than us. So take it or leave it. One day, long time, it grieves me, but he got better, and praise God for that.
Amen. Last question for Gavin.
Pastor Thabiti, at one point you compared a soldier in Afghanistan or Iraq and their lack of coming home immediately to fight abortion to the reality of when we see various types and different evils, we can't always take up that cause. And I don't know if I quite am representing your point exactly, so correct it if necessary, but how do we not use that sort of argument to, in our own minds, in our own justification of our thinking, say, that's not my problem. This is my problem, and specifically in light of the way Edwards was fighting his battles, I'll be like Edwards. His battles were theological, and he had revivals to worry about. And obviously, we're pointing out that was a faulty thought process. How do we not go there and say, especially at a place like this, oh, my battles are theological, so to speak, or pastoral, and potentially that would maybe you could steer that towards the blind spots of this stage.
Thanks. It's a great question. Thank you. It's probably a bad analogy, probably a bad illustration, but just trying to say when you're in the foxhole taking bullets, you tend to keep your eye on the guy who's shooting at you. Doesn't mean there aren't other things to address around you. And it doesn't mean you probably shouldn't pass some ammunition to the guy who's sort of on the other front. But in his setting, in his context, some things were looming large in his view, and other things were peripheral. So that's what I was trying to get at in that analogy. And I think that's inescapable. So to your question, how do we avoid that? We work to be well-read. We work to study the culture, the world around us. We want to read more than our local paper. We want to have conversations outside of our sort of natural circles and relinquish our passive approach to friendships and cultivate friendships with people not like us, again, in those natural ways in which we divide. So again, that we're getting some input from outside of ourselves. We want to be searching our own heart and praying about where the Lord would have us active. I don't want to minimize the theological battles, right? So I don't think we have to make some trade-off here between I'm going to give my life to theological pursuits and battles, or I'm going to give my life to kind of social battles. I want to fight against that false division. I want my theology to serve the life that I'm living and be applied in that way. And so you may find yourselves fighting on multiple fronts, and all of us will have to make decisions about the limited resources of time and life and monies and other things that we invest in. But the short answer is I think we really have to be educated, not just about where we live, but about the people who live around us and people who live elsewhere. We have to be willing to pick up our cross and enter into other people's sufferings and enter onto the battlefronts as the Lord gives us opportunity, as the Lord gives us skill, as the Lord directs our hearts in that. I hope that's helpful.
Well, we do need to draw things to a close. Again, if you'd like to continue talking with us, please come on up. We'll look forward to some informal conversation. Let me extend profound thanks one more time to Pastors Anyabwile and Love and Dates for leading us through a very important and very difficult conversation, very needful conversation. Would you join me in thanking them as we close?